Hello there. Welcome back to the booth here at Pro Tour Ether Revolt. That's Luis Scott Vargas. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. Now, I can tell you right now, of the top five best players of all time. Now, this is just my list. He's on it.
Fair.
But
you're just saying that because I'm sitting next to you.
There's also two other players that are on it that happen to be playing each other in the feature match area this round. We've got John Finkel versus Gabriel Nassif.
Oh, yeah.
And they're ready to go. Let's head down to the feature match area for round number 10. Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Ether Revolt. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Luis Scott Vargas. A lot of talk about the top five players of all time going on in our chat. We've got two of them in here. Gabriel Nassif, he's from France. Take a look at Gabe here. And his opponent, yeah, we know him. That's John Finkel. That's Johnny Magic. Team Puzzle Quest.
I think if you pulled the top 50 players, John would get the most votes for best player of all time. And I don't think it would be particularly close. Sorry, Kai, if you're watching.
There is a competitor. I think that you'd have a significant number of votes for Kai as well, but I do think
certainly.
That Finkel's...
Kai has... Yeah. There's a very good argument there, too, but I think Finkel would run away with that.
Yeah. Yeah, Gabe Nassif and Finkel, really with two of the best careers that we've seen here on the Pro Tour. John Finkel, really, it has to be said, you know, has had the longest best career.
John Finkel had a Hall of Fame career and then a post-Hall of Fame, Hall of Fame career, and then a post-post-Hall of Fame, Hall of Fame career. John could have made the Hall of Fame three times over.
Yeah.
Go. Okay. Can you say something? Because I can't really hear you.
I can hear you. I can, you can't hear me.
I can better hear you.
All right, go. I can hear you perfectly.
John has...
All right, well, I turn my... maybe.
16 Pro Tour top eights.
Yep.
Favorite, white
back. Normally the bar is about four or five. If you hit five, you're a very good chance to make it into the Hall of Fame.
So to talk a little bit about this matchup, both players' decks look quite good. John has a white-black deck headlined by Fumigate with a lot of good value cards in it. Had a very good pack of Kaladesh, multiple Glintsleeve Artisans that Fumigate. And he's playing against Nassif, who's got a bit of a brew here. So Nassif is playing white blue.
Play
it. You see all blue lands, white lands, a bunch of blue and white cards, a bunch of good flyers. Nassif also is splashing Whirler Virtuoso and Rogue Refiner. He's splashing red and green, thanks to three copies of Renegade Map, Prophetic Prism, and two Aether Hubs.
Wow, okay, he went deep.
As Nassif is known to do.
Yes, he's got a Hinterland Drake here to start applying pressure to Finkel's life total, who has kind of been spinning his wheels here. You can see that the only things he's really done are make implements so far. Two implements of improvement, one implement of malice. Gabe Nassif decided to discard his expensive card, the Windkin Raiders, there.
Yeah.
All right, and this is a nice little play here from John Finkel. He's got a Defiant Salvager. He's just going to use that and activate it right away here to get the plus one counter on his creature. But of course, when implements go to the graveyard, from the battlefield, you still get to draw the card.
Yep.
Draw a card.
Speaking of drawing a card, there's Prophetic Prism for Nassif.
He drew the land he wanted. That was both Nassif and Finkel both drew a card on their main phase to try to hit a land drop, and they both succeeded, which is why I assume they're among the best of all time.
It's one of the reasons. There are others. Finkel, I think, thought that Nassif was passing the turn back, but Gabe was like, well, no, I've got my land drop to hit, and he might even play a Countless Gears Renegade here post-combat.
Yep. Yeah, no revolt, but Nassif has all spells in hand, so he's going to end up in a situation. He's got that Aethertide Whale, Rogue Refiner. He's got a lot of action. He's not really going to have an opportunity to play the Rogue Refiner or the Countless Gears Renegade later, so he'd rather just play it even though he doesn't get the servo.
So John's going to attack for 3 damage, knock Gabe down to 17. John's still at 20 thanks to the implement of improvement. Okay. And John has a solid follow-up here with one of his two Glintsleeve Artisans.
At Hinterland Drake, gonna keep packing in though.
It is. Interestingly too, we have two of these just absolute all-time players here. And you know, John is a limited player. You put Magic cards in his hand, he's going to do well with them. But, you know, primarily he loves drafting and he loves limited, where Nassif is more known for constructed than limited.
Certainly. Nassif, you know, historically has had a much higher win percentage in constructed than limited, whereas John, well, has a great win percentage in both, but is, again, more known for his limited prowess. John, of course, part of Team Puzzle Quest, playing against Gabriel Nassif. Part of Team Opportunity, though, John and Nassif frequently on the same team, you know, leading into the Pro Tours.
Yeah. No blocks from Finkel.
18.
Down to 18. Yeah, that Aether Tide Whale is going to be supremely annoying for John as it dodges the removal he's got and even some of his best cards, like Fumigate. It's like Gabe's got an Airdrop Aeronauts. Is that what I saw in his hand?
Yeah. Again, not doing a great job of getting Revolt, but still just a 4-3 flyer is going to just put John under a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Yep.
And that is what he's going to play. So he plays a 4-3 flyer, passes the turn back, and John is just going to have a hard time racing here. Though he could find a removal spell and really change that.
John has a Fumigate in hand as well.
Mm-hmm.
So John has incentive to want Nassif to commit a little bit more to the board without John doing anything, but it's very suspicious if John just goes land number five, you know, maybe attack with my Defiant Salvager, go. Because if you're Nassif, Nassif's very deliberate and someone who thinks a lot about what could be coming and what your opponent's representing, he's not going to look at John and be like, no, I guess you'd probably just have nothing. He's going to think, why would he do that? Oh, something like Fumigate might be the answer.
John's going to sacrifice the Servo to the Defiant Salvager.
Servo hanging out in the graveyard there.
Yeah, this is interesting. He's actually going to sacrifice the rest of his board here to get 3+1+ encounters and make it a 5/5. I'm really curious to see what John does here. He does have a play. He's going to play a Night Market Aeronaut and put a +1/+1 counter on it. So his line is not a Fumigate-based line, at least not currently. He's using it more as a reset button. As the Night Market Aeronaut does do a nice job in the air, it can trade off for the Airdrop Aeronauts or just gobble up the Drake if it were to attack.
Nassif also, unfortunately, drew Renegade Map as his sixth land of sorts, so he's not able to play that Aether Tide Whale quite yet. Because Aether Tide Whale is going to do a pretty good job of playing around Fumigate here. Just lets Nassif commit to the board without actually worrying about removal. Nassif also doesn't even have great attacks, so that Nightmark and Aeronaut is doing a lot of work here.
Yeah, the best attack that Nassif has is just offering a trade in the air.
Nassif also has Felidar Guardian, so he's got options as to, you know, if he wants to, like, exile either of his Revolt creatures, have them come back and have Revolt trigger.
So the Aeronauts is going to get into the red zone, and John says, yes, I will oblige this. He's going to block. That initiates a trade. Now what's going to happen?
Well, he can either play Rogue Refiner or Felidar Guardian to draw a card. The Guardian could blink the Prophetic Prism. Or Rogue Refiner, of course, just draws a card naturally.
Ooh. Doesn't Steve have a land drop to give here? He does, but he doesn't have the land, it looks like. He drew another Hinterland Drake with that. It would have been nice to go land Drake, but that is not how that worked out for him. Curious to see what John does here.
I think that Aether Tide Whale is going to just be a huge player this game.
I think so too.
It's a great card, and it just lines up so well against Finkel's sorcery speed removal like Fumigate. Because one of the ways this turn plays out is Finkel attacks with Defiant Salvager, and Nassif just double blocks with the Rogue Refiner and the Countless Gears Renegade, because they're not doing a whole lot for him anyway. Then John either has to commit more to the board, or just wait and try to get value off Fumigate, but facing down a lone Hinterland Drake, it's not like Fumigate is that exciting.
Right. Yeah, the Aether Tide Whale is one of those cards that when your opponent plays it, you think, okay, I can do something here. I got something, right? And then you think about your deck, and you're like, no, I just don't. I just can never kill that Aether Tide Whale. I have to race it. I have to force somebody to block with it and not bounce it, that kind of thing. Okay, so that transaction happens. John trades his one creature for two of Gabriel Nassif's.
And see, look, this is great. Nassif just immediately snaps off a double block. Any removal spell or pump spell would punish him there, but he just can't worry about that. And yeah. I think that is just like the clear right play there, and yeah. something yeah. that a lot of players would be worried about making.
Cogworker's Puzzle Knot was the follow-up for Finkel.
Yeah, we might see an upkeep Renegade map, perhaps, if Nassif thinks he's going to need the land this turn. And the reason to do that is so it reduces the chances of him drawing a land on his draw step.
That's right. John's going to think when he sees his mountain.
Yeah, after Nassif's played all white and blue lands and then a blue-green card.
Right, and then he's just going to go get a mountain out of his deck. It's kind of funny.
So Cogworker's Puzzle Knot actually works out quite well for John. It's a way to spend your mana without committing much to kind of bait Nassif into playing more creatures into Fumigate.
Right.
The problem that's not going to work out well for John is that Aethertide Whale is just going to make that Fumigate plan much, much, much worse than it would be otherwise.
That's right. Aethertide Whale... 6 energy. When he enters the battlefield, he can pay 4 energy to return it to his hand. He can do that anytime he wants.
So now John's looking at his Fumigate and Caught in the Breads and be like, wow, this plan's just not going to work. I need to...
Right.
And he needs to assemble some blockers for it, and that's really all he can do. And John's looking at his options and he just can't be happy to see that. I mean, Aethertide Whale is one of the cards that really just turns a lot of game plans on its head.
It really does. Again, I think that, you know, John realistically could think through his entire library and only come up with a couple scenarios where he can realistically get rid of the whale. You know, you can go for a removal spell and keep up an instant speed removal spell so that if they don't have enough energy, they can't do it. But look at how much energy Nassif has.
Yeah, he's got
that
eight
handy.
Thanks to the Rogue Refiner, he's going to be able to bounce the whale twice. So, again, John's best bet is to assemble 4 power worth of flyers so at least he can double block and make it so Nassif can't attack. But that whale really did turn the tide here. John went from being in a position where if Nassif played another good creature, Fumigate would be just a clean 2-for-1. But... no longer. It now is almost a dead card.
Okay, plan B now. Yeah. A major change of plans here for John Finkel. He's going to pay an Aether Poisoner and then his other copy of Glintsleeve Artisan. Yeah. And really his only option here is to try to race that Aethertide Whale. The problem is Nassif can just dictate how he wants to play the game from here on out. He doesn't even have to attack with it if he doesn't want. He can just leave it back. Like he has so many different options now. John Finkel's at 16 life and taking 8 damage here, though, so this could be a quick one as Nassif works his way towards the finish.
Don't normally hear quick one and Nassif in the same sentence. Nassif, again, very known for his deliberate pace of play, but this game looks like it is ending soon.
Yeah, John may have to play a Fumigate just to not die. He could gain some life from it, force Nassif to replay his whale.
Go.
All right, is this the turn where he has to cast Fumigate? I mean, he's...
Well, John can use...
Got Caught in the Brights.
Caught in the Brights or Gyarpur Osprey to buy time against the whale, so he doesn't... He has to play one of those 3 cards, but... He's still in a position where he's losing to the whale and the assorted flyers quite quickly. This is a situation where John needs something like Inspired Charge. If he had Inspired Charge or some other way to pump his team of servos, then he might be able to try to like sneak in enough damage, because Nassif doesn't have a ton of blockers. He just has the one Weldfast Wingsmith, but it's still... That deck doesn't get drafted all that often, the white-black go-wide deck, so it's just not something that John has access to right now.
John's attacking with everybody. Going to trade off, take some damage, drop down to 9. He Yeah, it's just an awkward spot for Finkel. The Aethertide Whale really just making his life difficult here. It also just seemed to turn his entire game plan around. You know, he was kind of crafting the board to maximize Fumigate, and now all of a sudden he's had to completely scrap that plan. And as you might imagine, there's some casualties in that transaction.
So Aethertide Whale is not a card that'll bring you back if you're like very far behind. If your opponent's playing an aggressive deck, often it doesn't do as much as you would want. But it is the kind of card against a removal deck, which, you know, Finkel has here. He had multiple removal spells in hand when the Whale got played. It is just very, very, very difficult to deal with.
So this is a speed bump for the Aethertide Whale.
Much like the Gremlin in the picture.
Indeed. Though that was slightly before speed bump status. John's keeping the pressure up with the Osprey. He's trying to find a way to get that last 9 points of damage. It is going to be very difficult through this Whale, though. Looks like Nassif's deciding when he wants to bring the Whale back to hand, I suppose.
He's also deciding whether he wants to play Aether Meltdown end of turn here. Just because if he thinks he's going to cast the Whale next turn, you might as well Meltdown on like the Osprey right now. Or potentially the Aether Poisoner, just to make sure that you're casting as many spells as possible and end up not dying to some random assortment of cards.
Yeah, cards like Inspire Charge will go through his mind. There's fewer of those around in a draft, but they do still exist. Looks like Gabe's thinking about attacking.
You might not want to attack with Hinterland Drake just because it can keep the Osprey back, and Hinterland Drake plus the Whale is lethal regardless of whether you, when you attack with the Drake. But this also means that if Nassif plays multiple spells this turn, he's in a spot where he's able to potentially get lethal through next turn.
Well, he's going to do it the easy way here. Feldar Guardian, he's just going to blink the Whale, so he doesn't even need to bother using the energy. That puts him up to a hefty 14 energy after that as well, and he has his Whale back online. So this is a more mana-efficient way and energy-efficient way.
It also lets him deploy a trusty companion as well, because now Nassif has three blockers for Finkel's four attackers, which makes it so much less likely that he dies to something unexpected. Finkel were to cast Fumigate, he would gain a lot of life here.
He is. He's going to do it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8-ish. Put him up to 14.
1, 2, 3. How many guys did you have?
I had 5.
The problem here is inevitability, right? If you're sitting in Finkel's seat, you're making plays that are moving you slowly towards your game plan or delaying it, but it feels inevitable that that Aethertide Whale will just eventually stick and do enough damage to kill John Finkel.
Yeah, because John did get a lot of life. He cleared the board, but it also means he has no pressure, and Nassif actually is the first person to get to play cards. So,
thanks. All right.
There might be another minute at the end.
Run.
Savage cheating.
Yeah.
You hear that?
Yeah.
So what happened there was Nassif paid 6 mana to return the Whale. It actually only costs 4. You get 6 energy. Sorry, not mana. Energy. And you get 6 energy when you cast, or when the Whale enters the battlefield as well. And John said, Savage cheats.
For trying to spend too much.
For overspending on his energy. These players have played with and against each other for years and years and years. There's Audacious Infiltrator picking up Conviction. But that's all that John can muster, and he's out of gas, and he knows the writing's on the wall here. 3 short turns, and that Aethertide Whale will make short work of John's life total. It's going to be very tough for John to push through 9 damage through the cards that that Nassif has. Remember, the Aether Meltdown still in hand for Nassif as well. That ended up being a smart decision not casting that, because he would have lost it. It would have just gone away.
Yeah, and I think John at this point is just going to, actually he's just going to lose next turn to the Whale plus to Hinterland Drake.
Yeah.
And this game was just dominated by Aethertide Whale.
It was.
That card just blanked all of Finkel's game plans. It was just a huge flying threat that was impervious to removal, and that's what the card does. That is why Nassif, picked it highly and played it.
Yep. And that's going to do it. Game one goes to Gabriel Nassif. A big smile on his face there. And even John has to crack a smile and say, all right, you got me. He cast Fumigate in a game of Limited and did not win. That doesn't happen very often, especially when you're John Finkel. So we've got more Magic action for you right after these messages.
Check out Aether Revolt Booster Draft Leagues on Magic Online. Build a deck at your own pace and play at your convenience. Draft anytime, play anytime. For more information, visit mtgo.com.
It's time to take back the power.
Welcome back to the Feature Match area here in Dublin, Ireland. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Louis Scott Vargas. We're in round number 10. We're watching draft. And we've got two of the best players ever to play our game. We've got 25 Pro Tour top 8 sitting at the table right now, Louis.
That's a lot of Pro Tour
top 8. A few more in the booth here as well. So let's get game number 2 underway between these players. I can also update you on our other games, other matches in the Feature Match area. Liu Yuchen, the only undefeated player left in the field, just defeated Tian Nguyen from the United States. So 10-0 now for Liu Yuchen from China. So fantastic stuff.
He's got to get two wins over the next five rounds.
And he still gets to play one more with that nice draft deck.
Oh, yeah.
And then we've also got Martin Yuza from Team Channel Fireball Fire versus Dimitris Triantafylou. He's from Conflagrease, and they're in game three. How are we looking in the early stages here?
Nassif just got a slight advantage there. Shielded Aether Thief, jumping into play to block that Night Bridge Patrol means that Nassif generated an energy, and now he's sitting there, and as soon as he can generate a couple more energy, he gets to draw an extra card, which Nassif is a fan of drawing extra cards. I can verify that.
Yes, he is.
Nassif's deck is nice.
You say as he plays his third different basic land type of four. And right on turn three.
Well, the two Renegade maps he hasn't played kind of speak to why he can get away with that.
That's right.
I actually think Nassif could splash more cards if he had them, with the three maps, Wild Wanderer and Double Aether Hub, but he's in the Prophetic Prism, but he's relatively restrained here, just a Whirler Virtuoso and Rogue Refiner.
An implement of improvement for John Finkel. He's just going to work that through right away, maybe trying to hit a land or something. Looks like he says, all right, well, I'd rather get damage in for two and let you have an energy out of the deal.
That trade is just not that great for John. Trading two damage for an energy against a shielded Aether Thief, which is just looking to draw an extra card as soon as it hits that third energy. But I guess John's in a position where he's just, is he not going to attack at all and just kind of concede giving up damage on the ground?
He's decided that that is not the situation he's going to find himself in. You know, part of the deal could be his cards in hand. Part of the deal also could be that, you know, he respects that Aethertide Whale to know that he does need to just push through damage. He can't just sit here forever against Nassif's deck. He also knows that Nassif has gone way deeper on the colors than him and potentially has access to a bunch of different splashes and things. And generally speaking, I think the longer the game goes, the much more it favors Nassif. And I think Finkel's recognizing that and prioritizing just trying to get in damage now while he can.
Fortunately for Nassif, he's drawn a lot of lands here.
Look at that.
His hand is Metallic Rebuke and Illusionist Stratagem in hand.
He's almost got Domain, Louise.
He's very close.
He's got four lands. They're all different basics. But you're right. He actually hasn't found a lot of action somehow still.
Though, he's getting closer. If he gets to block this turn, he gets to draw an extra card with the Shield of the Aether Thief. That's just great.
And that's exactly what he's doing, and it's still just two damage hitting Nassif. It's time 16. More implements for John Finkel. They do take up mana. Let's see if he's got a follow-up. Maybe another Glintsleeve Artisan?
I suspect Nassif's not going to be having any of this.
Good.
He can draw with the Aether Thief in response to see what his options are, and maybe he doesn't want to use the Metallic Rebuke, but otherwise it's going to be hard-pressed to not let John, you know, to let John advance his board here when Nassif just has nothing in play.
So first things first, let's draw a card and see what our options are for next turn.
Trusty Companion does change things a little bit. It means you have a 3-2 blocker, and you can leave up Rebuke next turn, but the other thing you have to be concerned about is Metallic Rebuke going to be dead soon because John has five lands in play.
Right, he has a relatively low curve deck as well.
And so one reason the Seif may not crack Renegade map here, in fact it looks like he's not, is he does have Revolt cards in his deck. He has like Airdrop Aeronauts or Countless Gears Renegade. So just leaving the map in play when you're hitting land drops anyway makes a lot of sense. Plus it does help pay for Metallic Rebuke if that becomes an issue.
Trusty Companion for Reaver. Let's see if it gives him an additional blocker.
Something like Rogue Refiner would be such a good draw right now because it would power up the Shielded Aether Thief and just put a 3-2 on the board, plus draw another card.
Wow, it sure would be. Looks like Conviction for John Finkel.
It's not bad. It lets him attack with an additional servo, but it doesn't get past the Aether Thief still. The Aether Thief has done a lot of work. It's prevented something like 5 damage and drawn an extra card, and may draw another one this game. So, Nassif, considering trading the Trusty Companion, the one reason not to is that Ninth Bridge Patrol will start growing if Nassif starts trading off for creatures here. Nassif's still a pretty healthy life total as well.
And this is going to take the 4 damage and drop down to 12. an audacious infiltrator for John Finkel. Is this going to draw the metallic rebuke from Nassif?
I think that he's getting to the point where he just has to cast it, because otherwise he's going to be down 6 creatures to 2 here.
Yeah, he doesn't, you can tell he doesn't really want to,
but he is not going to. And he almost wishes he had cast it on the Glintsleeve Artisan instead. He was just hoping for a better target to come along.
Yeah.
Let's see, with a 15-land deck, but plus the 3 maps, ends up getting a little flooded right now.
He's got an Aether Hub to give him any color of mana that he possibly could want at this point.
Though, critically, it does give him a second energy, which means that once the Aether Thief blocks next turn, he'll get a third energy, which means an additional card. Because even though Nassif's flooded, if he's drawing extra cards off the Aether Thief, if he's casting Illusion Stratagem, he gets out of it pretty quickly. He finds a bunch of new cards.
Does get interesting. Airdrop Aeronauts in hand for John Finkel.
Yeah, that's a big flying threat.
Yeah, that's the kind of card that can close out a game quite quickly, even against this scenario.
No answer to that.
Yeah. And John's still attacking on the ground. Though that one extra energy from the Aether Hub means that a block from the Shielded Aether Thief will give him 3 and another card if he wants it.
Let's see if one reason not to trade off the Wild Wanderer. He does have that Illusionist Stratagem in hand. He might want to blink the Wild Wanderer at some point here to get an extra land. The Lord Garden is kind of nice. If you get to reset Glimpsleeve Artisan,
get a counter,
and get a counter on your ninth creature.
Yeah, that's pretty nice.
And then John could get a servo here, or he could make a 3-3. Yeah. Given the Shielded Aether Thief just making a servo and trying to go wide, trying to just, at some point just start attacking with everything, it seems like it's a pretty good plan.
Yeah, I like that plan from John as well.
Ooh, Airdrop Aeronauts, huge draw for Nassif, because now he's got Renegade map. He's 1 mana short of playing Aeronauts and having Illusionist Stratagem up, but
yes.
If he can conserve the Aeronauts for a turn and bounce it with Stratagem, then...
Did you see that?
Yeah.
So... That was just a subtle non-play, but Nassif cracked the map and then noticed that the top card of his library was the Aethertide Whale. And he kind of showed it to Finkel there, too.
Oh, yeah. So Finkel knows Nassif doesn't have Aethertide Whale in hand.
Yeah.
Opie draws it this turn.
Of course.
That would have been great.
Yeah.
But Watchful Automaton, not bad either, though.
Hey, when you're
just
flooding.
Just another, and a 3-mana play on a turn where you just want to deploy 2 spells.
Yeah, absolutely.
The 5 life here from the Aeronauts is just going to go a long way.
Yeah, and there we go. Gain 5. Back up to 13. And then a solid 2-2 blocker to follow it up with the Watchful Automaton.
You get stressed out every time they...
So this game was pretty close until then. I think that the advantage shifted slightly in Nassif's favor thanks to that Airdrop Aeronauts, because he's got more of a long game here. He's got Stratagem, which is going to gain him 5, draw him a card, maybe get an extra land. He's got Shield Aether Thief drawing extra cards. He's got, if Watchful Automaton lives, he's got the ability to scry. So John is going to need something to push through damage here, because right now the board is getting clogged up, and Nassif has all the engine cards. John has... Well, he has a conviction he can keep bouncing and moving around, but that's nothing in comparison to what Nassif has going.
Right. Yeah, this one's looking pretty bad for John Finkel. He's at 7-2 record-wise. You can see that Nassif is on 6-2-1. So still solid records for both of these players, but they do need to string together some wins to put themselves in contention for top 8. A few hours away here as they work their way towards the standard rounds. John is in a tough position here against Gabe. John Thriotis draft yesterday.
Okay.
Yeah.
So John's going to immediately go to his attack step.
So Aether Thief can block a 3-3. And then Watchful Automaton can block a 1-4. Trusty Companion can trade for something. Servos can get blocked. This attack, basically, this attack is John trying to represent some kind of combat trick and Nassif deciding how much he wants to play around it. Because on the surface, the attacks are just not that good for John.
Right.
But Nassif has the option of basically the extra five life gives him the luxury of playing around a combat trick a little bit and maybe not putting the Aeronauts in harm's way, maybe not putting Wild Wanderer in harm's way. So he has to decide how much risk he's willing to take. If Nassif just assumes John has nothing, which is correct, John does not have anything, Nassif can just snap off some great blocks here. But he knows that, John knows that, and that gives John some incentive to attack and kind of represent having some kind of combat trick, at which point Nassif may be hesitant to make you know, assumptions that are, well, in this case, correct, but he doesn't need to take that risk. So Nassif is looking for blocks. I mean, he's going to make some blocks, certainly, but how much risk he's willing to take is really what the big decision is. How much does he want to put a 4-3 on a 2-2 that he really hopes nothing goes wrong there? He really wants that 4-3 to live.
You can see he's thinking about Inspired Charge here.
One of the cards he's thinking about right now, because Inspired Charge would actually just make things go very, very poorly for Nassif. But I love it. He's just snapping it all off. He's just like, you don't have anything. These attacks just end up so poorly for John.
He is getting decimated.
John loses three creatures. Nassif gets an energy, yes. And Nassif takes two. That is the net result of the attack.
Well, but John also gets a bunch of counters on his ninth Bridge Patrol. He also has Revolt now for his airdrop Aeronauts. Life's not super important here, but he does get that as well. But that ninth Bridge Patrol is now a 6-6.
It's true, but...
But yeah, he lost basically all of his board. Pretty brutal.
Yeah, the net result of that attack was very positive for Nassif. And part of that, I mean, look, John is aware of that. He knew that that was one of the outcomes. He felt like he was in a position where he was losing, because he was, and he had to hope that Gabriel Nassif would play around potential combat tricks in a way that was beneficial for John. As it turned out, Nassif had come to the conclusion that, no, you don't have anything, and he's going to block like that. And then at the end, and the end result was John losing a bunch of creatures.
You can see why we're using that advantage bar, by the way, on your screen. Life totals are betraying the actual potential to win the game at the moment. Scry one on his upkeep. For Nassif, he used his Watchful Automaton here.
Yeah, that Illusionist Stratagem now gives Nassif the opportunity to gain five, search for a land, and draw a card by blinking the airdrop Aeronauts and the Wild Wanderer. Nassif is just in very, very good shape here. Keeping an extra land in hand to discard to something like Implement of Malice.
Land off the top for Finkel. Things not looking good for John.
Yeah, and that was a big turn for John. He needed to find something to not, you know, to push through, to not lose to Nassif's overwhelming advantage here. Though, that airdrop Aeronauts now that gaining conviction does mean Nassif eventually has to deal with it, but Nassif has a lot of time because he gets to block with Aeronauts, blink, gain 5, go to 16, then he can start attacking back. He's scrying with the Watchful Automaton. All Nassif has to do is find either a 2-power flyer or an answer for the flyer in general, and Nassif has a very good shot this game.
Take 5.
Good.
Nassif just took it. He's down to 6. He's just going to scry. Dig, dig, dig. Got a lot of things to do with all that extra mana. Upkeep Scry as well. He found a Hinterland Drake. He's looking at it like, is this the thing I want?
Well, Hinterland Drake does let him double block the Airdrop Aeronauts with his own Airdrop Aeronauts and Hinterland Drake.
Yeah, that's 6 power, so that's enough.
Which will then offer the trade of Airdrop Aeronauts for Airdrop Aeronauts, which is pretty good.
That's really the only card that Nassif seems particularly worried about at this juncture.
Yep.
So he's just going to play the Drake and pass.
The one thing I'd be uncomfortable with if I was Nassif right now is that I don't have mana up for Illusionist Stratagem, which will annoy me because that makes this combat so much safer. Nassif could take 5 and go to 1, but then he dies to any combat trick and potentially loses to some, you know, very odd sequence of random 1 damage type effects. Mountain, Implement of Combustion. Unfortunately for John, Nassif might be backed into a corner enough that he just can't play around anything, and then he just runs the double block, and it just doesn't work out great for John. So John can actually return the conviction and still have this trade happen.
Yeah, that's what he's going to do. Six counters now on this ninth bridge patrol. It's getting pretty big.
Looks more like a 10th or 11th bridge patrol at this point.
Yeah.
How much time do we have there?
Defiant Salvager is going to pick up conviction. And once again, John Finkel finds himself with no cards in hand. This is Scry on end step from Gabe Nassif. And he's going to keep it on top of his library. This draw step for the turn, he kind of just skipped through that.
Aether Theorist can get a little bit of extra energy to use with the shielded Aether Thief, potentially Scry. I do think that the Watchful Automaton plus shielded Aether Thief still give Nassif a pretty sizable advantage here, especially since John's not very close to getting damage through on the ground, and Nassif has Death Dismissal in hand if John plays a small flyer. Though Conviction does kind of blank Death Dismissal.
Yes, it does.
John's likely to put Conviction on any of his flying creatures that he can find.
Nassif back up to four energy, so now he can start scrying with a Theorist or even just drawing an extra card.
Scry with Watchful Automaton, Scry with Watchful Automaton, draw a card with Shielded Aether Thief. Nassif just ripping through his deck here.
Right, and you know that that Aethertide Whale's in there somewhere as well, though he may not even need it this game.
And the now 16th Bridge Patrol is getting to attack, but Nassif can end up throwing creatures in the way here. So it's a 5-8, 5-7 rather.
Yeah.
Defiant Salvager and a 9-9 Ninth Bridge Patrol, which means that Nassif can stack up enough creatures to threaten to kill the Salvager, but is unable to do so with the Ninth Bridge Patrol unless he wants to commit. Well, he needs to have one more. I can commit all his creatures, but instead he's going to go for Illusionist Stratagem here.
Does he want to draw a card?
He did want to draw a card first if he wanted to use it this turn. He's not going to be able to right now.
No, he didn't. You could do that with that ability on the stack, but he decided not to. And he paid the last three mana. They're doing a little shortcuts there, but...
Yeah. But that's being mindful of time here.
Exactly. I heard Nassif ask a little earlier, how much time do we have left in the round? He's heavily advantaged in this game, though. John has come up with a pretty cool attack force here. It is, well, right now Nassif does not have an answer to those two huge creatures and is going to have to start blocking them repeatedly. And Finkel's at 25 life. It's going to be hard for Nassif to start to race that. So this gets kind of interesting.
Yeah, I think that John has bought himself a little bit here because even though Nassif's drawing extra cards, it's still in his favor, but not as much as before because John just moved all in on just making two gigantic creatures and forcing Nassif to block every turn or risk dying. Likely a sideboard card of Consulate Crackdown, but not in a position where it's very good.
Is that Solemn Recruit there for John Finkel? Interesting.
Pre-combat Solemn Recruit. Oh, because John is just not attacking into Nassif's board. That's very good for Nassif. Despite Solemn Recruit getting larger thanks to Conviction every turn, the fact that John's not attacking just means Nassif's engines have a lot more time to get value here.
Yeah, John wanted to use his mana efficiently there. He played the Solemn Recruit. He replayed the Conviction to get that counter thanks to the Revolt from Conviction and also just get it back down on the battlefield. He's got a tidy conclusions in hand. I think he'd like to try to tempt Nassif into some type of big multi-block that he could maybe punish.
An Aether Meltdown from Nassif that he just found is going to make that a little bit harder.
Yeah, it is indeed. Yeah, Nassif has... It kind of annoyingly for John Finkel kept four energy case he plays the whale, he'll have the ability to return it immediately. You know, when it enters the battlefield, trigger goes on the stack to get that 6 energy. If
right.
Nassif doesn't have the energy at that point, so if John had mana up, he could, for example, use an instant speed removal spell to kill the whale. But I don't think Nassif's going to give him that opening.
Nassif's getting to the point where he can just chump block every turn and still not really run out of chump blockers thanks to scrying and drawing extra cards. He's drawing 2 cards a turn and he's scrying 2 or 3 times a turn. He's just going to find his look through his whole deck very, very quickly.
Yeah, he is. See what John wants to do. Replay Conviction.
Likely wants to make an attack of some kind.
Yeah, it does look like it's about time. He's able to keep up 5 mana as well for the tidy conclusion.
And a 4-6 double striker, a 4-4 Defiant Salvager, and a 9-9 Ninth Bridge Patrol. I mean, Nassif has a lot of potential double block, triple blocks, quad blocks, you know, all sorts of blocks. But John has that tidy conclusion in hand, which is going to put Nassif in a pretty tough spot if he tries to, like, do what he's doing right now, which is stack up on Ninth Bridge Patrol and hope it works out. So this is one way John actually can regain some of this advantage, because when you go for a triple block and your opponent's tidy conclusion and you still keep a 9-9 in play, like that is pretty good value for you. Though Nassif may play around that by putting basically an excess creature on the Ninth Bridge Patrol to make sure that the plan works. And the Death Dismissal in hand actually will do that. So by triple blocking with 3/3s on a 9-9, John is going to tidy conclusion one of them. Nassif just lets the other two deal 6 to the 9-9 and then cast Death Dismissal to deal the last 3. And that will take out the Ninth Bridge Patrol.
What if John draws Fumigate?
Fumigate will help. The problem is it resets the board. John gets a conviction back and that's it. And Nassif gets to scry a bunch of times and draw an extra card on the way out.
For strike damage. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yes. Alright, before damage.
Nassif is going to use his Aether Meltdown to neutralize the Solemn Recruit. And John is going to go for it here. He's got the tidy conclusion.
Yeah, this
take out the Weldfast Wingsmith, but it's not going to work out well for him here.
This is going to work out really well for Nassif.
He's going to be good.
He's trading 2 creatures plus a Death Dismissal for a 9-9 Ninth Bridge Patrol. The Aether Meltdown stops the Solemn Recruit for now. The Defiant Salvager is trading for a Watchful Automaton. And Nassif gain an energy off the Shield Aether Thief. So at the end of this, the board is going to be much clearer, but Nassif is going to have essentially stabilized and still have a Shielded Aether Thief as a method to draw cards and an Aether Theorist as a method to scry. So that was very good for Nassif there.
He's an Audacious Infiltrator. He's not interested in it. Put it to the bottom. Draw a card. This is still an end step.
Ooh, Rogue Refiner.
That's a nice one. His library is getting a little thin there, but I think he's got plenty of time here.
Yeah, but he's got Aether Tidal Whale in his deck. Eventually, that's just going to be the card that finishes things off.
Indeed.
Oh, man, Rogue Refiner plus Felidar Guardian?
Oh, he's going off now.
And Whirler Virtuoso?
And Whirler Virtuoso as well.
This deck is sweet.
Yeah, he definitely did it. There's a Virtuoso back up to 7 energy. Attack in the air, knock you back down to 23.
And here is truly a time when the life totals do not tell the whole story.
Absolutely. Advantage bar, Nassif.
You have no cards.
And Nassif just has to worry about Fumigate, but with John on no cards, he's just like, well, whatever. If you have Fumigate, you have Fumigate. That, you know, you have to top deck it.
He's going to pass the turn back. He's going to look to try to close this game out as quickly as possible. John needs to find something to help stem the bleeding.
I don't know if Night Market or not is the solution here.
No, it's not bad. He did have Revolt as well, so he's going to get the +1/+1 counter. That will keep the Hinterland Drake at bay.
And also, the Solemn Recruit will eventually grow past the Aether Meltdown. That was a temporary solution at best.
That's right. Every turn, John has been putting +1/+1 counters on it. It does, in fact, have power again.
Yeah.
Only one.
The 1/5 double strike, a massive threat.
It is a problem. It is interesting. This game has... You know, it's felt like it was in Nassif's favor the whole time, and frankly, it still does. But John just refuses to give up. World Fast Wingsmith, probably not what Nassif wants exactly, but maybe?
Well, it's a 3-3 flyer because the World of Virtuoso can make Thopters to give it flying kind of at will.
For the next few turns, yeah.
So it might be enough to push through damage, but Aethertide Whale is really the card Nassif's looking for, so.
He will settle, though, for the Wingsmith. Go ahead.
And so it's a 4-6 flyer from Pinkel. So Nassif can make a Thopter, and he can triple block with the three-three Wingsmith, the Hinterland Drake, and the Thopter. The Nightmare and Aeronaut can take out the Thopter and a Wingsmith, but then John does actually lose the Conviction. Because remember, Conviction can get bounced at any time, but if you want to actually have it be relevant in combat, in a combat where you're going to lose your creature, you do end up losing the Conviction.
Nassif took it.
Yep, just went to two.
Yeah, he went down to two. And John's just going to return and then replay the Conviction. That's just a method by which to get another counter on Solemn Recruit. And it looks like Nassif has made a Thopter on end step. Two Thopters on end step. There's the whale. All right. That's the closer. Nassif, he likes to talk through his plays. He'll even do it verbally sometimes, depending on who he's playing against.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're going to block with this guy. I'm going to attack with this guy.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess that's okay.
Yeah, that's what he'll say. It's funny. I've gotten a chance to watch him stream. He'll stream drafts sometimes as well. And it's and construct it. It's really interesting to hear him talk through his thought process. He's very methodical with it. The great part is he always has the same tone of voice, no matter if he's getting smashed or if he's winning. So you have one of those.
I went up to seven, used free to make a Thopter, so he gets fine.
So Nassif went from one energy to seven off the Aethertide Whale, spent three to make a Thopter off the World of Virtuoso to give World Fast Wingsmith flyer, or flying, and is ending up...
Sorry?
I don't think you'd have permanently played this
turn. Oh yeah, I was cheating.
He actually didn't have Revolt after all that.
Yeah,
a lot of things entered the battlefield, but nothing had left. So the Countless Gears Renegade is just going to be a 2-2, but still... Nassif in a dominating position here, and now Finkel's desperate to find his Fumigate, and even then it doesn't really feel like it's going to be enough.
Yeah, Fumigate will just essentially delay the inevitable like before, because that whale will still just be lurking there.
John just passes the turn back. Nassif at two life.
Well, without John having some kind of damage that bypasses combat, which Black White is not known for doing,
yeah, there's a few cards in the set, but not in his deck.
Yeah, two life is I think, a bit far away.
Yeah, Ironclad Revolutionary would be pretty sweet. But he actually has one in his pool, but he didn't play it. Clock is starting to run down on this match, by the way. Have somewhere in the 2 to 3 minute range left on the clock. It is up to Nassif to finish this thing off. He's the one who's up a game already. And he has a very significant advantage in this game as well, but he needs to get the job done. John's still at 18. He's gained a lot of life this game.
And John has a 4-6 flying blocker, but Nassif might be at the point where he can just attack with everything and force John to either block the whale or take a bunch of extra damage.
Yeah.
There's four.
Can you attack with those four? He's just going to block the Hinterland Drake here and try to gobble that up. And like you said, that does mean a lot of extra damage gets through, namely the Aethertide Whale. So he hits him for 8, down to 10.
Now Nassif has to decide, do I play on instant speed removal? Because it is tempting to go bounce whale, replay whale, just to generate some energy. Nassif's got nothing better to do. I think there's a pretty good chance you just want to go for it here.
He can't. He's got 11 lands.
I like the timing center.
The first one he could do pretty easily, but if he does open up the door for another tidy conclusion or something like that.
There just aren't that many cards that punish you for this.
Yeah, and there's very few.
And getting
actually.
The extra energy, right, I think, would be quite relevant here.
I'm going to pay for it if he trains on shrimps.
Yeah, he's going for it. He says, you probably don't have it. And he was correct. So he nets himself two energy and an untapped whale now.
Your turn.
And then passes the turn back to Finkel. John finds caught in the brights.
That can prevent the whale from attacking for a turn, or weld past Windsmith, but that's about it. Since Kasif does have a Thopter back to block that Night Market Aeronaut here.
Yeah, in an emergency, he can also make additional Thopters with the Whirler Virtuoso.
Yeah. Good.
John doesn't have a profitable attack here, so he's just going to do the same thing he's done for the last three turns, which is return conviction, replay conviction, get a counter on Solemn Recruit, pass.
Which is now a 4-8 double striker.
All right, we are now in extra turns here, I should mention. Time has been called.
So,
I can't hear you.
Often when you're in extra turns, you're looking at like the match being a draw. In this particular case, since Gabriel Nassif is up a game, if this game does not conclude, Gabriel Nassif will win the match. So Nassif actually now has a slightly different incentive. He can still certainly win the game by attacking. I mean, that is legit. But he could also win this game by having it come to a draw. You see what happens if he attacks with everything. He has 3, 6, 8, 9, 10. He is exactly lethal, even with leaving the Whirler Virtuoso back, if John blocks the two biggest creatures. So how bad is it for Nassif if this attack doesn't work out? How bad is it if he's forced to bounce the whale? And I guess he can make another Thopter with Whirler Virtuoso. I think this is a pretty safe attack for Nassif here, because he gets to leave two blockers back anyway, plus the whale.
Sure.
Is he going to go for it?
He did say sure.
Six. You're at 10, right?
You're at 10, right? He doesn't want to.
You like it when your opponent says you're at this, right?
Yeah.
That just means that they have designs on your life total.
It does indeed. Cards in hand? Mind rot you.
Yeah. Sorry, guys.
He's thinking about it.
Attack.
Looks like he's not going to go for the full attack.
All right, whatever. Just attack with the wave.
He's decided just to attack with the whale.
Yeah, after all that.
And then the aeronaut's going to block it. And he's going to return it to his hand. Well, like you said, the truth is that this is turn number two, and if we get to turn number five, Nassif wins the match. He decides to take the much less risky line here and just leave his creatures back. And that's going to do it. John Finkel draws a Plains off the top. Can't find the action he needs. And in our Hall of Famer fight here in round number 10, it's Gabriel Nassif from France and Team Opportunity who defeats John Finkel 2-0. Oof, it's good stuff. It's just the highest level Magic. It's like you said, you get to see those plays where the massive attack goes in. And, a lot of times you see those type of snapshot plays and you just think to yourself, well, there's a lot of good blocks here, or maybe there's not. But, I like how you broke it down for us. Like, basically John saying this, and basically Gabe saying no.
I don't believe you. In fact, boom, boom, boom. Show me. And then John's like, I don't know.
Yeah, I didn't actually have it after all. And that's how it goes sometimes. I mean, when you're playing against players at the high level that you are there, John probably had a pretty good idea that he would figure this out, but I'm going to do it. It gives me the best chance to win over the long term. All right, that's going to do it for round number 10. Let's send it back to the news desk and Brian David Marshall.
Welcome back to the desk. It doesn't get any better than that. Three of the greatest players in the history of the game, John Finkel versus Gab Nassif, Luis Scott Vargas breaking it down for us alongside Marshall Sutcliffe. That was tremendous, tremendous magic. I'm going to give you a little bit of what's going on down on the floor. Josh Otter-Layton, I could tell you, defeated Mark Jacobson. 7-3 for Josh Otter-Layton. Josh Otter-Layton, someone who is on the top of everybody's Hall of Fame ballot going into the Hall of Fame process at the end of this year, but someone who really has a little bit of work to do to stay qualified for the rest of the Pro Tours. He's taken a real job. Maybe Magic's taken a little bit of a back seat for him over the last year. So he's really chasing goal, chasing being qualified for the rest of the year. 7-3, that's a good start for him if he can keep it going. Sam Pardee, I can tell you, from face-to-face games, defeated Brad Nelson of Team Genesis. Sam Pardee up to 8-2. Cesar Segovia, you Panamanian Magic fans out there, he righted the ship after losing the first round. He is 9-1. He defeated Kelvin Chu. Brotherly love in this tournament. Sean McLaren, he is 8-2 after he defeated Tatsuhiko Oki. But little known thing about Sean, everyone talks about him as a loner. He's actually at this tournament with his brother, Dean McLaren. Dean McLaren's at 7-3 after he defeated Marcelino Freeman. Jan Cassander, young up-and-coming Czech player, he's at 8-2 after defeating the Hall of Famer Ben Stark. And Dimitri Triantafylou, who we talked to yesterday, he has not lost yet today. He's at 9-1. He defeated Martin Yuza. Now, I can tell you, we've been talking about this draft format. We got to see two drafts this morning. Right now, Ian Duke is over at the wall, and he's ready to show us another draft from that feature draft table. Let's send it over to Ian Duke to see a draft feature.